Thank you all for joining us today. I am so happy to see all the excitement that we have for this Bulletproof Your Health Wellness Talk series that we've been offering. If you're joining us for the first time, I'll just fill you in. For the past few months, we have been learning about functional medicine. We've been learning about foods that heal and learning about root cause of illness and disease, and really how to live optimally. And I really have to say that we're learning all this thanks to our presenter, Dr. Vicki Peterson. And she is from the Health Now Medical Clinic in Sunnyvale. Dr. Peterson is a doctor of chiropractic medicine. She's also a certified nutritionist, and she's a best-selling author. And we're so fortunate and grateful to have her here today. Today our focus is learning about the toxins in our environment, how they get into our body. Dr. Peterson is here to enlighten us about what we can do to reduce the effects of toxicity, and really probably the whys and hows of cleansing our body. So I'm gonna hand over the mic to Dr. Peterson, and thank you once again. Just 1 minute, if you are watching virtually or watching our recorded version, I wanna let you know that we have a survey. In order to earn your points, you wanna complete Dr. Peterson's evaluation. It's the page 1 and 2 of this participant packet. Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, I'm
you have your mic.
I'm mic.
Yay!
Hello. Thank you. Thank you so much. So this is an interesting topic, and one that you will learn a lot, hopefully. It's interesting talking about toxins, because what I don't like to hear about are things I have no control over. So we won't be putting emphasis on air pollution. You got to breathe. So what I will be putting emphasis on are things you really have control over, plus telling you what parts of your body, when they function optimally, deal with toxins as well. So it's not this doom and gloom kind of, you know, statistics. Although I do start with a few doom and gloom statistics, but just to get your attention. Okay. So in your notes, there's a loose sheet that's a bio, and then there's another loose sheet that Tricia just referred to. That's the health survey. And by the way, the group that brings me here is called the Doctor Speakers Network. You can see that on the front of your packs of information. That is a national organization, actually, where doctors donate their time to educate the community more about their health. So I'm part of that group. So let's do the health survey together here under section 1, just to kind of see what shape you're in. This particular piece of information, this sheet, you turn in at the end. As you can see, there's a lecture evaluation at the back. So Tricia wants to see, you know, what you think of the talk. And then we collect it. Tricia gets the back, which is your feedback. And then I'm the only one that sees the front, which is your health symptoms. Okay, so let's look at section 1 together and just check these off as they apply to you. And at the end, I offer a gift, and if you want to take advantage of that, that's also on this sheet, but we'll get to that at the end. So the first question under 1 is low energy. So if your energy is not as good as you want it to be, check that off. Do you have your notes? Do you have your notes?
Everyone have their packet.
Do you have the notes? Good. Okay, good. And everybody has something to write with? Yeah? Okay, good. Any anxiety or nervousness you suffer from? This doesn't have to be 24/7, but if it's cyclical to some degree and it bothers you, then check that off. Sleep trouble, either too much, well, not too much sleep, but sometimes people say, wow, I get ample sleep, but I'm tired, you know? And so it's like, I put the body to bed, but I wake up and I still feel exhausted and I don't feel well rested. So sleep trouble can be that you're supposedly getting enough sleep, but you're still tired. Or you can takes you more than 20 minutes to fall asleep at night. That's a definition of insomnia. Or you're a light sleeper, you're a little in and out of sleep. So any of those are insomnia definitions. Environmental allergies, so these are things growing outside, dust mites, dogs and cats, anything like that that bothers you. Okay, shrimp scampi, anybody? Okay, digestive problems. So speaking of digestion, food. So then there's digestive problems, things like bloating, gas, constipation, diarrhea, acid reflux, colitis, gastritis, anything like that. And you don't have to have an official diagnosis, but you know sometimes you eat and you just don't feel that well afterwards. Any chemical sensitivities that bother you, you get in an elevator with somebody who has a lot of perfume or cologne and you kind of feel a little funny, or you go to certain stores and that bothers you. Question? All good? All right, now we're in the center column, autoimmune diseases. You or your family, by the way, either one for that one. Headaches, whether they're tension headaches or migraines. Hormonal problems, this crosses both sexes. You could have fertility issues or libido issues. Men can have prostate problems. Ladies can have problems with their menstrual cycle, perimenopause, menopause. Weight trouble, too much or too little. Muscle and joint pain. Thyroid disease, that would be for you or in your family. Any mood swings or depression that you suffer from? The notes are at the back. Are there still notes at the back? Yeah? Okay, good. I have more, Tricia, if you need.
I have some too.
Yeah, but I like the full cover and stuff. I like the pretty ones. Okay, good. So, great, we're going through this. So, thyroid disease, you or in your family. And then we're on the far right, mood swings, depression. Once again, that can be cyclical, but if it bothers you, that you experience it. And then the next three, you or in your bloodline family, cancer, diabetes, osteoporosis. And then periodontitis or gum disease that your dentist would have mentioned that you have. Okay, how did you do? Did you see yourself there anywhere? Yeah? Okay. So let's turn to page 5 of the notes. And that's actually one in. And body overwhelm, the root cause of illness. And this is a slide I always utilize, regardless of the topic I'm discussing. Because the whole point is I want to communicate to you the way I think about health, which is really different than our traditional model. And I want to hear from you if the way I think about it makes sense to you, or if it sounds very foreign and kind of unbelievable. All right, so you see the human body there, the outline of the human body, and then there's various lifestyle stressors coming in at that body, many of which I just asked you about. And so the question is this: can you have lifestyle stressors coming in at your body yet still maintain health? Good news, yes. If you had to be devoid of all lifestyle stressors in order to have a healthy body, we'd be in trouble because health would be unattainable at that point. So what this says on the top right, when the definition of a healthy body, is that it's one that's fully adapting to the lifestyle stressors coming its way. So that's a key point. So it's okay to have lifestyle stressors as long as you successfully adapt. So you go, okay, that's great. How do I know if I'm adapting or not? So on the bottom right, it says symptoms. And the key there is that symptoms is your body's way of telling you that it's not adapting, that it's having a problem. So it gives you a symptom to tell you, I need help, okay? That's why your body gives you symptoms. It's important to realize that the body does give you a symptom for a reason. There is a cause underlying that. Do you have a question? No? Okay, let me know if you do. So there is a root cause underlying the symptom. Now, what do we do in our country? Do we treat symptoms or root cause?
Symptoms.
Yeah, we treat symptoms. And what do we like to do with our symptoms?
Medicate.
We like to medicate, that's right. And what does that do you suppose, to get to the underlying root cause of the symptom?
Not much.
That's right, it doesn't do anything. So as time goes on, because we're ignoring that root cause, it will create other symptoms trying to get our attention, and we can drug them, you know, too, but it's still not getting to the bottom line. So when I was a kid, I developed migraines. I was a teenager, and I was told by my doctor, well, your mother has migraines. And that was the big sort of solution, if you will, to my migraines. And, you know, if you've seen a family member suffer, you know, especially you're only a teenager, and I'd watched my mother with these debilitating migraines my entire life, and it was beyond depressing to go, oh, great, this is my life. You know, this is what I have to look forward to, this moaning in the bed and the, you know, all that went with that. So We also both passed out from low blood sugar. It was a very healthy childhood. But anyway, long story, so this was me, my like little laundry list of symptoms, but I was able to cull it down to a key root cause. And in the clinic, it's usually one or two key root causes that when properly addressed, these actually go away. And I haven't had a migraine in decades. And she was 40 years my senior. And she, once I fixed her, she never had another migraine again, even though she suffered her entire life. And that can sound a bit maybe unbelievable, but it works. Does it sound unbelievable, or does it sound like just not something we do traditionally in medicine? What is it to you? Does it have an unbelievable, like, oh, she's fantasizing, or do you think it's possible? Yeah, okay. Yeah, most patients come in and just say, that makes so much sense. Why don't we do that? You know what I mean? But we do live in a very drug-oriented, pharmaceutically-driven society, and the thing about root cause is that to get to the underlying root cause, like for me, there was a diet change I had to make and thereby a lifestyle change I had to make. And, you know, there was also a neurologic change that somebody helped me with. I couldn't do that for myself. But there was some responsibility on me that I had to do, that I had to change. So sometimes patients come in and say, you know, give me any vitamin you want. I know you don't do drugs here, but I'll swallow anything. Just don't make me change my diet. And I go, just fire me now because it's not going to work, right? So that's the hard part. And we tell patients that from the get-go. And that's why we offer free consultations to people, is so we can talk turkey from day one. You know what I mean? It's like, okay, here's reality. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. I'm known for the unadulterated truth. People go, yeah, I know you're going to tell me the truth. It's like, that's right. But this is real. When the American Heart Association, we didn't do heart disease, or did we do heart? Yeah, we did do heart disease. So I brought up the fact that the American Heart Association, they have their DASH diet, which I forget what that acronym stands for, to figure it out. Probably, you think H is heart, right?
Approach to hypertension, something like that.
Oh, okay, great. So anyway, their diet was based on this landmark study of hundreds of thousands of Americans and what it took to reverse heart disease. And it was a great study, you know, double blind, placebo, you know, just the creme de la creme of studies. So what they found that was needed to be done dietarily to completely reverse heart disease, the DASH diet didn't reflect that completely. And said, so, well, if you base your diet on this landmark study that actually reversed heart disease, why is your diet different? And they're like, oh, Americans won't do that. You see? So that's where we're kind of stuck, is a lot of traditional doctors don't get a lot of nutritional background in medical school. There's a group that's trying to improve that. But they're also, you know, if your own doctor doesn't do it, what's the likelihood, you know, they're going to ask you to do it? And they just don't believe you're going to do it. You know what I mean? So it definitely is some discipline. And the way we run our practice is a lot of hand-holding. You know, if you go on YouTube, you'll see me in my kitchen cooking. Not because I think, you know, it's cool to video me cooking. It's because I created these videos for my patients to show them you can cook fast and healthy and easy without, you know, without it being difficult, right? So anyway, I digressed a little bit, but it's really important because our health status is so poor here in the U.S. You know, 52 industrialized nations, and our health ranking is around 49 to 51. And we spend twice as much to get there. The per capita cost of healthcare is twice as much as any other industrialized nation, and we rank bottom of the barrel. It's sad, right? And it actually has a tremendous amount to do with what's on the end of your fork, you know? But we just don't know that, because you certainly aren't told that by the McDonald's commercials and the Coca-Cola commercials, and right? You know, it's like, treat yourself, you've had a hard day. You know, these are the messages you get, not, you know, food is information and what's on the end of the fork is telling your body what to do. Okay, good. So I said I'd only start with the bad, scary statistics and then we'll leave them alone. But here's just a few scary statistics about toxins. So the average American uses about 25 gallons of toxic hazardous chemicals. This isn't in your notes, so just listen. 25 gallons of toxic hazardous chemical products per year in their home. The major portion of these are found in household cleaning products. Women who work at home have a 54% higher death rate from cancer than those who work away from the home. So it was a 15-year study concluded it was a direct result of higher exposure to toxic chemicals in common household products. So apparently women stay home and we obsessively clean. Men, not so much, apparently. Okay. It was only because it was a dominantly female audience, sir, that I said that. You're okay, though. He doesn't care. Okay, good. The toxic chemicals in household cleaners are 3 times more likely to cause cancer than air pollution. So that's interesting because, yeah, we can't avoid the air, right? But you can certainly avoid what kind of cleansers you use. According to the National Research Council, this is interesting. There's no toxic information available for more than 80% of the chemicals used in everyday household products. Only 1% of the toxins are required to be listed on labels because companies can classify their formulas as trade secrets. And that's how they hide the toxins. Very interesting. In the past 75 years, and this correlates, this statistic correlates to autoimmune disease because there's been a very dramatic and rapid increase in autoimmune disease in the last 50 years. And even though autoimmune has a genetic component, it's not explained by genetics because genetics just don't change that quickly. It's hundreds of years to change genetics, if not longer. So in the past 50, more than 75,000 chemicals have been introduced into our environment. And today, there's 300 synthetic chemicals found in the bodies of humans, even newborn babies. So a baby, we could go to the hospital right now, and a baby could be born, and you just go, can you give me a few drops of the cord blood? Nobody's using it, you know, just a few drops. And you will find what's called POPs, which is persistent organic pollutants, in the cord blood, and there'll be substances that haven't been on the market for more than 2 decades. Yeah, it's pretty amazing. So they call them POPs, persistent organic pollutants, and they'll find dioxins and things that they haven't produced because it's not just mom to baby, it's grandma to mom to baby. That's how long they persist, you see? So they talk about these babies these days of being born in like this little cesspool, sounds awful, I know, of chemicals because the trickle-down effect is just amplifying. And that's what we didn't realize, because you take one chemical, right, and they say, okay, we created a chemical. Great. What does it do? Get out some rats. See what it does to the rat. What would be toxic exposure? What wouldn't be? You know, and they very, very safely figure out that it's quote-unquote safe. But what they haven't realized is that there's bioaccumulation, okay? Bio is life. So these substances accumulate and become more toxic because of their accumulation. So you can't say one chemical unless there was only one on the planet, which quite obviously there is not. You see, so that's how we're being affected, is this bioaccumulation and the persistency that we didn't appreciate when we started producing all these chemicals. Okay, so that's the babies. Oh, you know, there's a lot. Oh, here's probably the last one. Okay, so within 26 seconds after exposure to chemicals such as cleaning products, traces of these chemicals can be found in every organ in your body. 26 seconds. Isn't that mind-blowing? Yeah, yeah. Okay, so I'm going to start with BPA because this one will annoy you. Oh, I guess these studies were in your notes. Sorry about that. Well, anyway, they're yours to keep. Yeah.
And wouldn't that make you even wonder why there are so many animals that are coming down with sicknesses and whatnot? Like these animals, like who would have thought a dog was going to get cancer?
Right. I know.
That you clean your house with.
Yes. It's
your
true. Yeah. Yeah. And the chemical cleaners in the carpet and all that stuff. No, you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. So I know, and they you can't tell them to not do, you know, that. Okay, so BPA is, you probably heard of it because, you know, when it first came out, the plastic baby bottles went away because this was an endocrine disruptor and would have a more dramatic effect in children. So you saw BPA-free. I don't know about you, did anybody think when the new plastics came out, well, what did they use instead of the BPA, right? I mean, you know, it's like you got to think about it. So I did think about it. Anyway, I wrote a blog. So this was an expose. It was released by Mother Jones. The researcher did an amazing job. So 2008 was when the dangers of BPA were brought to light. So the author of this was Mariah Blake. So she researched it extensively. She said 80,000 chemicals, so we've added another five. So here's what they did. So the whole thing about BPA was that it was an endocrine disruptor. So it would offset hormones. Well, when your hormones are offset, that can lead to cancer and obesity and autoimmune, you know, pretty much everything you want to avoid. That's what endocrine disruptors do. So what they did was they found this, you know, this new, you know, BPA replacement, and it was called Triton. And it was from Eastman. Remember Eastman, it used to be Eastman Kodak. I think it's now Eastman. So anyway, so what they showed on their studies was that the plastic, the chemicals in this new plastic was safe, that it wasn't an endocrine disruptor. So this is what she found out, is that it was an industry-funded study, meaning the company that made it funded it. So then you always go, oh, great. So they used a particular species of rat from the Charles River, called the Sprague Dawley rat, like you care, I know. But anyway, it's a highly unique species because it's insensitive to estrogen. So they said it was safe, and it doesn't get affected by estrogen. I'm sorry, that's just disgusting. So because this is like sippy cups and moms trying to, you know, with the little pants, all this stuff, you know, and it's safe, and then they spent a lot of time, you know, like vegan restaurant, you know, like higher, not higher end because then they don't use plastic, but you know what I mean? Restaurants that try to sell, you know, more healthy food, but it's still, you know, not as expensive, you know, spent extra on these, like, you know, this kind of plastic because it didn't have BPA. So anyway, it's just a taste of the way they try to manipulate us, which really bothers me. So the bottom line is this. I mean, I switched to the metal bottle like I see you guys have, or they have the glass bottles with the plastic sleeve around it. Same thing with the baby bottles, you know. Now they have that plastic sleeve around it because you go, it's glass, the kid's going to throw it. Doesn't matter if they throw it. It's nice, thick glass, and it has the plastic around it, but it's not infiltrating the bottle. Same thing with Tupperware, you know. Yours is glass, right, at the bottom? Yeah, so she's got a Tupperware top, but as long as she doesn't stick, well, first of all, I don't think you should ever use a microwave. I know, thank you for the show and tell here. Right, she never microwaves it, smart girl. I mean, I don't think you should microwave anything, that's a different topic, but yeah, as long as you, if the plastic is just on the top, and she doesn't put hot food in it. So the hot food, the heat of the food, if it's super hot, will cause some of that plastic to get back in the food just from the heat of it. So if I ever go to a restaurant, which I don't very much, but when I do, I'm like, don't put that in plastic, you know? So if they come back with plastic, I'm like, okay, thanks, and then I just throw it out. So have them put it in paper, things like that. That's the deal with BPA. Okay, good. So antibacterials, if you use an antibacterial, just make sure that it's an alcohol base, because triclosan, which is the antibacterial in so many of the antibacterial cleansers, et cetera, is another endocrine disruptor. And it causes resistant bacteria because it can't kill all the bacteria. So the bacteria it leaves are the superbugs, which we really don't need. The thing is there's what's called a hygiene hypothesis. And what happens when, especially it's starting with children, when they're developing, the immune system is introduced to new things. That's why if you have a child, you know, your pediatrician says, you know, when they're ready to start food, introduce one food, wait a few days, introduce the next food. You know, give them a few days for the immune system to go, oh, what's that? That's different, you know. But there's two parts of the immune system. There's the, oh my gosh, that's different. And then there's the voice of reason that says, give it a day or two. let's see how it is, right? And these two balance each other back and forth. If you just had the, you know, reactive part of the immune system, you'd never be exposed. You couldn't get exposed to anything without your immune system just attacking everything. So it creates what's called oral tolerance, you see? So the body tolerates new things because the immune system says, oh, okay, you know, give it a sec. Yeah, okay, it seems fine. And now you've introduced a new food, right? What's happened with what's called the hygiene hypothesis is that part of oral tolerance is actually, the young lady at the back talked about, you know, the dog's crawling around the carpet. Well, the babies are crawling around the carpet too, and hopefully they're out in the backyard a little bit, throwing some dirt in their mouths, which, you know, horrors of horrors, but, you know, good clean dirt, as your grandma used to say. But that kind of thing is part of how you build a healthy immune system, actually. So they looked at city kids and farm kids, and the farm kids were so much healthier. When they compared their immune systems, because there's no way you're going to have a perfectly clean farm life, right? You know, even if the house is clean, the kids are out there, you know, with the animals, et cetera. So these super, you know, clean kids where, you know, the dad has the antibacterial around this like tool belt, you know, and they're spraying every time, you know, the toy drops. I mean, when my kids, when they dropped their pacifier, I'd stuck it in my mouth and I'd stick it back in their mouth, you know, it's building oral tolerance, you know? They're healthy kids. So we got a little too crazy in the antibacterials, and it's really suppressed the immune system. So now we have kids with a lot more allergies and asthma and autoimmune disease because we never got a healthy immune system. So if you know any little ones around you or moms or dads of little ones, tell them about that. All right. So we've known since 2010 that triclosan, which is this chemical in antibacterials, has been a problem. And the FDA announced a formal inquiry in 2010, but still hasn't done anything yet. So the evidence actually emerged in 1994, and it's still on the market, unfortunately. Triclosan turns into dioxin in our water system, which is carcinogenic. So that's a little scary. Okay, so you know, part of, as you know, obesity and overweight is a huge problem in the U.S. And a lot of times it's caused because chemicals will induce what's called energy storage. So if you haven't too much toxins in your body, the body goes into what I call hold mode. The official term is energy storage, storing everything. Because it knows there's a lot of toxicity inside, and the body requires a lot of effort to try to deal with that on a day-in, day-out basis, versus when the body finds a healthy, normal weight, it does so because it doesn't feel that it's polluted interiorly. You know, in other words, you can take in food, and it can burn it, give you energy, and not hold on to things. So sometimes patients say, you know, nothing I do, this body will not lose weight. And so it's very important, you know, with dealing with weight is to not put the cart before the horse, as it were, and to deal with any toxic load first, or you won't lose the weight. Have you known anybody who's done silly weight loss, as I like to call it, where they've done like a medical weight loss, where they've taken speed, essentially, or they've just starved themselves somehow, and you know, you go, oh, you look great because they've lost weight, but then you look at them and they look really unhealthy? Does anybody had that experience? Yeah. I mean, there's healthy weight loss, which is slow and subtle, and you shouldn't know, it shouldn't be that dramatic unless you haven't seen the person in, you know, 6-9 months, and you just go, oh my gosh, you know what? You look great, right? Because it happened nice and slowly and healthfully. But if, you know, just a month or two goes by and somebody's lost, you know, 20, 30 pounds, it's like, oh, okay. That's when you lose it so fast and you gain it right back plus more typically, because the body won't have it. You forced it, you've overwhelmed it with a drug, like, you know, type of speed, and it will lose the weight. But what happens is the reason the body's holding the weight is it's kind of diluting the toxins a bit. So now you force that rapid weight loss, and now the toxic load you know, is more pronounced. And that's why they'll look sick. They'll look kind of drawn and sick and, you know, not very healthy, even though the pounds are less. So if you've seen that, that's that phenomena. And it's very important, as I said, not to put the cart before the horse. So when someone comes in, I want to lose weight, go great. Typically when people want to lose weight, everything else is not hunky-dory in their body, you know. So I go through a really thorough history and look for all the other facets that are leading to this issue. I'm like, okay, so we're going to handle that first, and we're going to handle that. Then we're going to get weight loss. And I'm like, I know you're not happy. You want the weight loss first. I get it. But I feel like if we just talk about it and they understand why, then it'll make sense. Because ultimately, if you do have some pounds to lose, you want it to be stable, right? You want it to stay off. Permanently. You don't want it to just come off and then come back on often more. Okay, Tylenol is a big one. I don't know if anybody here has any babies, but baby Tylenol was taken off the market. The liquid Tylenol was taken off the market several years ago. And that was because what they discovered. Now, you know the liver is your detoxification organ, right? So interesting, when you look at the liver, is that the way the liver deals with toxins is that a toxin comes in and it goes through what's called phase one of detoxification. And interestingly enough, when it leaves phase one, it's actually more toxic than when it arrived, which sounds weird, but of course, it's instantly supposed to go into phase two. So it's phase one, phase two. So it's more toxic here, but then it's supposed to instantly go into phase two, and then it leaves the liver what's called water soluble, so you can just pee it out. Okay, so that's the liver dealing with toxins. The problem is phase one is an easy phase to do, and in many Americans, phase two is what's called sluggish. So it's a bit slow. So what happens is because it's slow, toxins come out of phase one rather rapidly, but then phase two, they're waiting in line because it's a little too slow. What happens is the body doesn't like it, the liver doesn't like it when these guys are sort of waiting in line, so it says, all right, you just go take a tour of the body and come back, okay? It's kind of like, you know, the Christmas holiday and there's long lines and you just go, let me look around a little more, see what else I can get. This line is going to take forever. The problem is when those toxins take a tour, they're doing something called oxidation, and oxidation creates effects that lead to heart disease and cancer. So when they take their tour, they're doing evil, okay, which is why phase one, phase two is supposed to follow one another very quickly. Now, the reason the liver the typical American has a sluggish phase two is that we don't have enough. See, this is oxidation, so we don't have enough of what would handle oxidation, which is antioxidants. And that's found in your fruits and your veggies, which is why I ask my patients to consume 9 servings a day of those. The average American gets like 1.5. So we're low in that, and the most robust, strongest antioxidant the human body produces is something called glutathione. I'm only bringing up the weird word for this reason. So we were talking about Tylenol. So several years ago now, something was discovered by the graces of the internet and how doctors could communicate to one another, is that they were discovering that people were coming in and needing liver transplants. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times these were young people in ostensibly good health, not somebody who had liver disease, you know, where it's like, okay, I finally got so bad they need a liver transplant. These were sudden, like, oh, do you ever have any liver? No, now you need a liver transplant, right? What was going on? And what they discovered was that one of two things had happened. 50% of the people that needed liver transplants, 50% of them had taken Tylenol correctly, okay, the way the bottle recommended, but they had also mixed it with some alcohol, but not to excess. Just like, oh, you've been suffering with a headache or something like that, and you were taking, then it's Saturday night, you know, and you had a drink or two. Like nothing crazy, right? So these were the sort of the acceptable level, and then these people took too much, okay? So, of course, these were the confounding groups. Like, what happened? These were youngish people and needing liver transplants. So what they found was that Tylenol annihilates your glutathione. Just annihilates it. So if you're the typical American who's not that healthy, so this is what they found. The patients that were most vulnerable had poor antioxidant status. Well, I'll just tell you, that's most Americans having poor antioxidant status. Some abused alcohol. They ate a poor diet. Well, gee, that's pretty common. And then have some underlying infections, which hopefully we'll get to, that is another stressor. So that's when baby Tylenol was taken off the market because babies have immature livers, right? And so they took that off the market. And the combination of Tylenol with codeine, which is what they gave me when I used to have my migraines, that was taken off the market because that was that combination. So those combinations got taken off. Tylenol is still the number one bestseller worldwide for fever and pain. But you got to know about this and share this with people that you know because it has a very scary liability. And then we used to say, well, you know, if you're not taking Tylenol, take an NSAID, like a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. And that's things like Motrin and Excedrin and aspirin, Buferin, Midol, Advil, Aleve, you know, all of those are NSAIDs, which means non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. The problem with NSAIDs is they damage the gut and they weaken your immune system. And when you've been on, and the biggest thing they do is that if you use them for more than 10 days at a time, they increase your risk of heart attack and stroke. 10 days at a time. So that's why getting to the root cause is so key because, you know, these are the two major sources of medication that people use for pain.
Question.
Yeah.
So with the Tylenol, you know, you have a different effect if you're not consuming alcohol.
Uh-huh.
Well,
no, the risk of it is several things. Alcohol was one. Using other medications was another. Having poor antioxidant status, which most Americans do. Having a poor diet, which most Americans do. You know what I mean? So it's just how that combination might hit you. Write your question down, and I'm going to answer it at the end. I've got just a few more minutes. So it's just that magic, you know, that perfect storm kind of thing. Yeah, so that's why... we want to get to the underlying root cause of the pain. It's like, why are you taking the Tylenol? Well, I'm in pain. Okay, why? You know, let's get to that. Same thing with the NSAID. You know, why are you in pain? Let's get down to the bottom line. Because all these drugs have side effects. And the one with Tylenol, I mean, people think Tylenol's so innocent. You might know that there's no more baby Tylenol. I had a patient come in and she says, yeah, I'm having my sister-in-law from, you know, some European country bring baby Tylenol because they took it off the market. And I'm like, did you look at why they did? Ay, ay, ay. Okay, so heavy metals, you probably know, you know, mercury is not a good thing. Heavy metals, they're found in vaccinations you might not have known. They're found in fillings of your teeth. Mercury increases your risk of autoimmune disease, which, as I said, has really taken off in the last 50 years. But here's an interesting one. Is high fructose corn syrup, you know, found in the sodas. You might have heard that's not good for you as far as obesity and diabetes, but they actually have, how do they describe it? In high fructose corn syrup is mercury residues, to the tune that more than a vaccine. So they say that the average U.S. intake of, there's 50 milligrams of high fructose corn sweetener a day, as equivalent to 28 micrograms of ingested mercury. But a vaccination that we tell people, okay, if you're going to get a vaccine, make sure they take out the mercury because you can get them with or without, so you want to ask for that. One vaccine only had 25 micrograms. So, but we're getting 28 per day if you're, you know, a soda drinker and, you know, candy and stuff like that with the high fructose corn syrup. So it's dramatically increasing our risk of brain illnesses as well as autoimmune disease. So definitely get the high fructose corn syrup out of your diet. Okay, so we talked about the bad stuff, and there's more in your notes. But let's look at how your body is designed to deal with toxins. So we talked about the persistent organic pollutants, you know, and the heavy body burden. But here's the deal, is if you can limit what you have control over, like the things we talked about, then the only other side of the equation is to enhance the part of your body that's designed to deal with toxins, okay? So your body is designed to deal with toxins. And those two systems are your digestive tract, where 70 to 80% of your immune system resides. And of course, your liver, as we were just discussing, because its job is detoxification. So if we can, you know, keep the favorable balance here, you're going to be fine, okay? So you need to understand what are some of these things in your environment that you can control, the plastics, the high fructose corn syrup, the Tylenol. You know, get rid of those things. Do the cleansers. This is all in your notes. You know, the cleansers where you make them at home. It's vinegar and a little alcohol and a little, you know, bleach. And you can make very safe cleansers at home. Dirt cheap, highly effective, doesn't have the residues that affect your hormonal balance. And you do what your grandma did, you know? It worked, they work terrifically well. So there's, and you know, you just make a big jug, you get a spray bottle, it works, you know? So these are, if you, as I said, if you control what you can control, then you don't have to worry about the air pollution. You know what I mean? The things you have no control over. You don't have to if we've got this going on, meaning these guys are working well for you. So that's what I do with my patients. I educate over here, and then I make sure that I enhance over here. And the way we do that is there are tests that we do that are called functional lab tests. Now, these have been around for a very long time, probably close to 25 years now. Have you ever been to the doctor because you didn't feel well, and they ran a battery of tests, and you were told you were fine? Has anybody had that? Yeah. And it's like, of course, you're so thankful they didn't find anything gruesome. So you're like, oh, good, you know. But then you're driving home going, yeah, but what about, you know, the thing that brought you in there, right? Because they didn't give you an answer. They said you were fine. So traditional labs tests, and this is why, remember, I started this whole thing saying our status as Americans is so low amongst the industrialized nations. And part of it goes to this problem, which is we have these lab tests that have a broad range of normal. And then there's a certain threshold you cross, and you're told you have a disease. And that's what you were told. You were told you weren't there, okay? You didn't cross the disease threshold. However, functional lab tests are more sensitive. The disease threshold is the same. However, at this end of the spectrum, you have optimal functioning, and then you have the middle section, which is malfunction, also more correctly known as inflammation. So this test would say, oh, no good. Why? Because you left optimal. Do we want to just wait till you get to disease? No. I mean, the beauty is, as we talked about in the heart disease lecture, and I mentioned in cancer and diabetes, is that you can be here and the body can still get well. It can still heal. It's a little harder. Sometimes it's gone too far. But the beauty here is you haven't hit this threshold yet. So absolutely we can bring you back left. And that's our problem, is you're told, oh, you're fine, you're fine. Oh, okay, now I got the drug for you. Now we have a label for you, you know. You knew way ahead of the game that things weren't right. You knew because it's your machine. But I have patients who walk in and go, well, you know, I don't know. Maybe I am getting older. I mean, I'm 33 now. You know, and that's when I let them know that the human organs are designed to last for 120 years. So So even the big 6-0 should not be like, you know, at 60, the organs are like, oh, I get it now. I get how I'm supposed to do this. You know what I mean? I'm ready for another 60. That's what should be happening. Not at 33 going, oh, yeah, well, you know. I'm like, you've got to be kidding me. But that's what we're inculcating. That's what we're, you know, impressing upon people. You know, well, you're under stress. You're this, you're that. These are tough machines. These are Maseratis, these machines you've got. You know, they're amazing if you treat them correctly, if you know what to do for them. The way they function is incredible. I mean, I used to pass out from low blood sugar. I had migraine headaches. When I didn't have my migraines, I had my regular headaches. I was tired all the time. I was more sore at 12 than I am at 59. I hurt all over. I was a mess, you know. Of course, I've been great for decades, but you never forget that, you know. You never forget feeling that badly. I was talking to a mom. We run a destination clinic as well as a local clinic, and I was talking to a mom yesterday, and she said her 11-and-a-half-year-old having problems, and she goes, well, she goes to gymnastics, and I was like, so I asked her how her energy was, and she said she goes to gymnastics, and I'm like, no, I understand, but does she have to push herself? She goes, yeah. She goes, I'll pick her up at school, and she's exhausted. She goes, but then she goes to gymnastics, and of course, you know, she's only 11-and-a-half, and she kind of gets going and, you know, gets a little energy going just from endorphins, you know, the way you do when you exercise. And I said, no, I can relate, because I was a figure skater, and I was tired all the time. But, you know, you get going, right, and, you know, you get a little lift, but still, I was fighting against so much negative. I was pretty much, most of the time, I think back on childhood, was like, I was exhausted, you know, and headaches and pain and passing, you know, I was a mess, right? So the beautiful thing is that I just want you to know that these functional tests exist. Insurance pays for them. They're not super expensive. When I say insurance pays for them, caveat, not Kaiser, who doesn't know they exist, but PPO, sorry, you probably all have Kaiser. PPO insurances pay for them. Or, now not POPs, PPO. So the PPO insurances pay for them because they know they're valid. And then they're not that expensive. But I just want you to know they exist so you don't have to, like, suffer with, you know, being told you're fine when you know darn well you're not fine. Okay, did you learn some things? Good. Well, let me finish up and answer some questions, give you a gift for attending. So there's a lot of data in your notes. I didn't go through every page, but there's a lot of good data in there. And how to deal with these toxins more. So I always offer a gift, and the reason I do is that I don't want you to suffer with not feeling well any longer. So the bottom line is this, that there is a solution to how these bodies work, and if you've been sort of stuck in the catch-22 of being told the only problem, you know, the only solution is a drug, or you're fine, or this kind of thing, and you're frustrated at knowing you could feel better and wanting to feel better, then we offer you the gift of a free consultation where you can come over to the clinic, spend half an hour with one of the doctors, talk about anything about your health that's not the way you want it to be. It doesn't have to be exclusively today's topic, but, you know, something about you and you don't like how it feels. Then this is the gift, so it's a free consultation. So back to this page where we did our section one together. The very bottom, in the bottom left-hand corner, there's a little box. So if you put an X in the box, that's your signal to us that you'd like to take advantage of the free consultation gift. I'm always asked if you can also give this gift to someone else, like a friend or a family member. Absolutely. We're just trying to get America healthier. So if you put an X in the box for the consultation, please put your name and daytime telephone number across the top. And if those are watching remotely or listening remotely, you can do the same thing. I'll also write our website on the board, which is rootcausemedicalclinic.com. We just changed our name, by the way.
Really?
Yeah, I meant to tell you. But anyway, so X in the box, name, daytime telephone number, and then if you're watching at a distance or after this, you can contact us at the website. Even if you don't want the consultation, please fill out your feedback. We very much want to know what you thought of the event, as well as any other topics you'd like to hear about. This is our website, rootcausemedicalclinic.com, and just go to the contact page and let them know you were, you know, attended the workshop, and we can get the consultation. For those listening, the rest of you, we've got the paper. Okay, good. Question. You at the back had a question, and I asked you to write it down. Has that ability, yeah, yeah. It really depletes this glutathione, this very strong antioxidant, which puts your liver at risk.
Well, that's kind of strange because my husband ended up at the hospital a couple years ago with a bleeding ulcer. Mm-hmm. So they told him he could never be on Advil because he could only take Tylenol.
Now, that's because, remember when I'd written it here, but I erased it. That's because he was taking an NSAID. And remember I said in addition to the heart, it really affects the gut. That's why they told him to get off that, because of the bleeding ulcer. Because NSAIDs like the Advil and the Aleve and the aspirin are known to affect the gut. And fine, I'm not saying that was bad advice, but they could have mentioned the negative of Tylenol, you know? And then the key is get to the reason of why he needs the Tylenol. You know what I mean? Yeah, yeah. So it's, yeah. Yeah, that's a really good question. I like, when it comes to juices, I really like smoothies. So the difference there is that this has the pulp in it, you know, versus a juicer takes out all the pulp, and that's all the good fiber. And there's actually not just fiber, but study recently came out that there's very special antioxidants that you're losing too. So better to have that thicker. So apparently, because anyway, a company came to my clinic and they're like, this is all organic. And I'm like, that's great. I said, but why do you juice instead of smoothie? And he wanted to sell it to our patients. And it's like, this is my feeling. And it's, you know, validated by research. And he said like this, like the same thing the American Heart Association said about their diet. He goes, Americans don't like smoothies. They want a thin juice. I'm like, well, that's nice. If you educate them, maybe they'd like a smoothie or add some water, you know, dilute it a little bit, but still get that great, get the great fiber and get the great antioxidants. So so I like that. There's a lot of smoothie recipes on the site. What was I going to say? It's what I like about them is, you know, just get real balanced, you know, so make sure you're getting a nice variety of things and lots of water too. And, you know, if you go on a cleanse like that, it does shrink your stomach, so it makes it easier to then control how much you eat afterwards, which is a nice little jump start if you're trying to lose some weight. But then also see how you feel, you know? So if you go on it and you feel like you're gonna pass out all day, you're probably putting the cart before the horse a little bit, and we need to do some other work first. So we don't start with any sort of dramatic cleanses with patients until we get them more stable. So that's the only caveat. But thanks for asking, that's a good question. Yes?
Acetaminophen,
that's another name for Tylenol.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's the drug name.
Uh-huh. Then I'll have
yeah. What page are you on?
11.
Okay. Make sure I'm on the same page with you. Yeah, so these are all drugs containing Tylenol. Acetaminophen is Tylenol. Yeah. Yeah. So here's the key. You want to get to the root cause of why you need the drug and don't need it anymore. Of course. I got it. But it's the or longer part. You know what I mean? So you want to get on, you want to have it as short a period of time as possible, and you want to enhance your antioxidant status. So that would be the time to be eating 9 to 11 servings of fruits and vegetables every day to try to counteract the acetaminophen. Not that you shouldn't do that every day, but you know. Okay, thank you so much, guys. It's after 1, but I will definitely answer your question, of course, Tricia. But yes, if you have to run, I understand, just leave your that top sheet of paper that we just filled out. If you want the consult, of course, have your name, daytime telephone number, a little X in the box. But even if you don't, leave it on your table, please, so that we can get your feedback. Thank you guys for attending. Have a great day.